Welcome to the Prep Athletics Podcast. On today's episode, we interview my friend, strength and conditioning coach Blair O'Donovan. Blair is based out of Rockville, Maryland, and he has worked with the Baltimore Ravens, NHL's Washington Capitals, and at the LeBron James Skill Academy. He's also worked with pro teams in Indonesia, Taiwan, and Australia, as well as being the conditioning coach for the Jordan All American Classic and the McDonalds All American Game. Recently, he was the head strength and conditioning coach for the Washington Wizards in the NBA. Blair has been the owner of Healthy Baller LLC since 2013, and he and I know each other from working together at Gonzaga College High School in Washington, D.C. back in 2011 to 2013. In this episode, we talk about such topics as Blair, you know, working with Kevin Durant in high school, him working with the Washington Wizards and other pros. He gives tips to basketball players and other athletes on some of the best lifts. He gives good information on nutrition, sleep, and much, much more. So I think you're really going to enjoy this episode. And now, my interview with Blair O'Donovan. Welcome to the Prep Athletics Podcast. This is Corey Heights.
Some battles. I'm not sure if they got us. If they did, maybe.
So you will get better as a player during that year.
So it was kind of exciting, like, oh yeah, somebody wants me.
All right, Blair, welcome to the show today. You know, before we get started, I want to say that, you know, without you, there's probably no Prep Athletics. And for the people that obviously don't know our relationship, we coached together at Gonzaga High School in Washington, D.C. We were together there about 2 years at the same time. And I went to Taiwan on vacation just to mess around, visit a buddy over there I knew. And Blair, you'd worked there in the past. And you said, hey, you should have lunch with my guy at Nike named Jerry Ho. So I connected with Jerry. We had lunch. I was jet lagged. And Jerry works for Nike over there. So I met him at the Nike headquarters. It was the day after Jeremy Lin left at his peak of Linsanity. And Jerry was his personal like aide throughout the whole trip. So Jerry was exhausted, but he said, hey, do you have time to go to a gym right now and see some players? I said, yeah, sure. Why not? So I go to a junior high gym. I walk in there. And once I walk in, everyone starts doing a layup line. And if everyone makes a layup, they look over at me. And we're talking some more. And at some point in the conversation, Jerry goes, I want all of these kids to play at Gonzaga High School. And I said, well, they're not good enough. They don't speak English, but let me see what I can do. And fast forward about a year, I placed three of those kids at a prep school in Maine. One of those kids ended up playing D1, Lewis Wang. He went to University of Maine. And then from there, it all blew up to me actually coaching at the All Taiwan camp, working with Taiwan exclusively on a bunch of kids, including a lot of the eventual D1 players. And none of that would have happened without your suggestion for me to have lunch with Jerry Ho. So for the world to hear, thank you for that connection, Blair.
Well, hey, that's the perfect way to start this podcast off by making me feel old, because I totally forgot about that. Just totally forgot.
But isn't that crazy? So, in life, it is crazy. A little connect there can, like, now this is a full blown podcast and business, and it's crazy.
Yeah, it makes me feel good though, because I just I know we've had a long relationship. We've just done so many things over time. It's just a nice reminder of, like, yeah, actually, I forgot that I helped you get synced up with Jerry and stuff. It's really cool to see your evolution on everything as well from that. It's really neat.
Yeah, and yours as well. And, you know, we mentioned in the intro kind of your biography, but, you know, let's go back. Like, I know you played basketball in high school and you love basketball, but what was the moment where you decided you wanted to get in the strength and conditioning field?
The moment I wanted to get in, it was probably twofold. I have to say, like, well, look, I've always been interested in, like, human performance in some capacity, because I was just a very average athlete. So I remember my mom sort of, like, getting wind of that. I was in middle school. I was either sixth or seventh grade. And she bought me this book, the strength training book, and it was completely over my head. It was talking about percentages of weights lifted and all types of different just concepts and training models. I had no idea what I was reading, but I was still excited to read it. So there was a little bit of drive there. And then along with that same time, My cousin was, like, a part-time athletic trainer for the Pittsburgh Steelers, and he would send me, like, pictures, and he would send me programs. Somehow he got programs and, like, literally mailed it to me. And I was like, man, I feel like I had the Holy Grail. I literally felt like I had the holy grail of like getting stronger and faster. Not that I could necessarily know how to apply it to myself, but I was like, I felt like I had a superpower knowing that I had knowledge, right? So some interest really started there. Just being a very, you know, average high school basketball player at best, I was always looking looking for the ways to get faster, stronger, et cetera. Wanted to play Division I basketball, tried to walk on at Towson University, just was not good enough. Didn't realize even what it takes to even walk onto a Division I team. And in the process of training for that, I had came across a trainer named Jason Hadid. And he was really the first coach that really like took me under his wing, like arm around the shoulder, like really coached me, really taught me. I didn't really have much of a father figure in my life for many years. And so he sort of stepped into that role and by accident. And I'm so grateful for that. And it was really that time I was like, you know what, man, I love that he was helping me, but like, I knew that I could help people as well as I was learning across the way. And that was the clincher for me. It was like really that time in my life where I started to work for Jason a little more. This is during my college years, started working for more. And it was a craving. It was a craving because I'm a very shy, reserved person. Not as much anymore at 41, but I was when I was young, not confident, not sure of myself. And Jason made me all those things. He helped me be all these things because he believed in me. And he really helped shape my mindset of how I could coach kids or how I could coach people. I'd start seeing kids like, man, like that reminds me of myself. Like, I know they can do it. Let me coach them up. And it just became almost like an addiction a little bit, you know, like the whole thing really started with me really being addicted to the fact I wanted to get better myself. And I always say like, well, then I could sort of help my kids by accident, but it was really the love and care that I knew I can give to these kids and help them progress their career, unlike I received when I was young. And that's when I knew. So I knew probably earlier than I even thought, you know.
What's Jason doing nowadays?
Jason, unfortunately, was tragically murdered in 2008. Yeah, so a real shame, really sad. I mean, you know, he'd be a prominent figure in my life even to this day. Think about him all the time. He was, you know, back then, this is early 2000s. I mean, when there was like the Men's Health magazine was a big deal and like the top 100 trainers in the country was a big deal. He was in that list and he was big in the football scene, worked for the Baltimore Ravens for a little bit, helped the Redskins a little bit. He got me the job at the Baltimore Ravens when I was young, really football connected and well-respected across the nation. And he was doing some speaking gigs for Nike and stuff like that. So he'd probably be an NFL strength coach at this point in time, you know, if he decided not to stay private, which he was killing in private. So tragic loss, you know, but he's one of those coaches that I'll never forget the rest of my life. And many kids that worked with him as well.
Yeah. Well, I'm sorry to hear that, Blair. It's got to be tough.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah.
Well, speaking of a strength coach changing your life, you know, we have a mutual friend, Sean Brown, who's now the strength coach for West Virginia Mountaineers. But I lifted with him when I was a high school junior and senior, and he sat me down one day and changed the trajectory of my life by talking to me about the Air Force Academy, about Navy and West Point, educating me on that career. And without that conversation, my life would be completely different. And he changed it once again by teaching me lifts, helping me get more confident. So it's amazing how strength coaches can really impact a young man's life.
Absolutely, because I think it's one of the best ways, you know, just young athlete, male or female, doesn't matter. It's one of the best ways to quickly increase confidence and self-esteem right off the bat. Doesn't take a lot of time. You know, I mean, you could, as a kid, you adapt so quick. You get quick gains just because of that natural, you know, early on progress. And the confidence boost you get with that, it's pretty hard to beat that, you know, right. And then that becomes the cycle of like, I got to get better. I want to get better. I feel myself getting better. And you sort of, imprint on an athlete, you know, when you're able to help them get those feelings, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Now, part of your resume includes spending time at Montrose Christian. And at the time you were there, they had a player by the name of Kevin Durant on the team. So tell me what you know, one, what was he like workout wise? Did he lift weight? I mean, he's known to be skinny. So I'm not going to say you didn't work with him, because obviously there's some genetic things as well. But like, tell me about his work ethic, both in the weight room and then on the court. What did he possess that got him to the level he's at today?
Well, I'll back up with my first exposure to Kevin Durant, because not many people know this story. But so it's my first year with Montrose Christian, and I was working. I was the assistant strength coach along with Alan Stein, who was my business partner for a long time. And so he was really the head guy there at Montrose. And, so our first year we're going to a game. It's a Christmas tournament. We're playing against a team called National Christian. And on the scouting report, which was one of the most amazing things I'd ever seen, being a young coach walking into Montrose Christian and watching the Hall of Fame coach Stu Vetter, organize and strategize and see the scouting report. It was about as detailed as you could ask for probably most colleges, let alone high school. So anyways, the big deal in the scouting report was Kevin Durant. You've got to watch out for this kid. He can really blow up and crush it. You know, so we got to keep an eye on this guy. And so we win the game. We win the game by like 3 points. It was a battle, but Kevin Durant had like 6 points. And I was like, I don't see much about this guy, you know, super, super long, super skinny. He might've been 6'5", 6'4", 6'5", just super gangly, just like nothing to him. So fast forward a year later, we're at the Portland Invitational Nike tournament, Christmas tournament for Montrose, and Oak Hill is there. And I see Kevin, and Kevin must've blown. He must've went to 6'7", 6'8". I mean, he was so much taller. And I was like, oh my goodness. And that's when I saw him perform pretty well. And it was at that tournament actually where we had conversations with his Wayne Pratt's dad and some Nike folks, and helped organize, get him back home to Montrose Christian. And so, yeah, so I was able to spend that year around him, with him, stuff like that. Picked him up from his apartment with Alan, took him to the community center to get workouts. Did that even with Mike Beasley, because they live close to each other. It was just funny enough. Both second draft picks. And Kevin was a quiet kid, good kid, loved to be in the gym, loved to work. He was ultra skinny, as I mentioned, but the year he was with us, he put on 20 pounds. Mm-hmm. And as you can look at him today, you know, like you just look at his body over time. Look, he went to University of Texas, which is a phenomenal basketball program, but even more so a phenomenal basketball strength and conditioning program. Todd Wright was the strength coach there, highly respected across the world. Now he's a director of performance with the LA Clippers. I mean, he's just a big time guy. And, you know, Kevin works hard. He doesn't avoid the weight room. He did not avoid the weight room. He knew that getting bigger and stronger would help him. It's just, people's body types are just different. You know, if he was really capable of blowing up on the weights, you know, he'd be 6'9", 300 pounds right now, muscled up. Like he doesn't have the genetics for that. Can't lift enough weights for that. And it was a shame, because, you know, coming out of the combine, he was really, he got really kind of beat down. And I remember ESPN beating him down for not being able to do 185 pounds on the barbell bench press for the combine. They had even called out, they didn't call out the name, but they said, whoever his trainer is, you know, needs to be fired or whatever, you know, as if they know like what it takes for a 6'9 guy with a 7 foot plus wingspan to bench press 185. And I love that story, even though it frustrates me sometimes because people just don't really know better or understand what goes into it. But like, I love it because Kevin told us specifically in this part of the story, he's like, I looked at all those GMs, those coaches, those trainers that said, I'm not going to be anything. I'm going to be too frail. Said, I'm going to score 30 on you. I'm going to kill you. I'm going to rot. You know, I'm going to beat you guys down. Like, he really took it personal. And sure enough, look at him now. You know what I mean? He's really showed up. He showed up on day one. We actually went out to his first game against the Nuggets, his first NBA game. He had a pretty good starting point in the NBA. But good worker, good kid, was never afraid to put the time in. It's just, hey, man, you know, hey, look at me. Look, I'm a 6'1" white guy, 175, 180 pounds, depending on the time of the year. And I love lifting weights and I'm relatively strong for my body. but I'm not built like the Hulk, you know? So we all have genetic limitations, you know, and Kevin was meant to play basketball, you know, and that's why we're blessed and grateful to be able to see him as one of the best players of all time, you know?
So there's plenty of players at that height that become big guys, but could you tell, like, aside from the weight room and on the court, what did he have beside his physical attributes that got him where he is today? Because the reason I'm asking this is every kid, about 95% of the kids that reach out to me, and probably the same that you talk to, want to play in the NBA, right?
Sure.
And I'm more curious about guards, what they have that separates them from everyone else. I mean, Kevin's obviously 6'11 now or 6'10.
Yeah.
He's got that DNA, but still, to have the skill set he has, what did he possess, Blair, that got him to this level?
That's a great question, because I'm going to be honest with you. Like, when I watched him play, and I was hearing all, I was not hearing, but I was seeing all these coaches come through to recruit Kevin and know that he was high on the radar. I thought he'd be pretty good. I just didn't think he'd be like one and done. I didn't think he'd be NBA MVP. But then again, I was also young in my career. I hadn't really spent extensive amount of time with these types of guys. You know what I mean? So like, it was a big deal. We had Gravis Vasquez on our team.
Yeah.
And Gravis is born in Venezuela and came to Montrose Christian as a sophomore and ended up being an excellent point guard at University of Maryland and played 7 years plus in the league, I believe, and had a pretty good career there. I was more excited about his game than I was for Kevin, because Kevin was just like a quiet assassin. I mean, I don't know if many people know this, but he didn't score that much in high school. We had a loaded team. He was like, he averaged like 14 points a game at Montrose Christian. And then he goes to Texas and he averages, I want to say, I know I'm wrong with this, but he was higher, but he was probably around the 21 point per game average. And then he goes to the NBA and then he scoring even more, you know, 28 per game, right? That's not a normal progression. It usually is reverse if you think about it. You're the 28, 30 point scorer in high school. You're the 20 point scorer in college. And then maybe you're the 10 point scorer in the NBA, right? It's supposed to get more difficult. It got more easy for him. So I didn't look at Kevin and think, oh man, that guy's an NBA ticket. No, we just didn't think about it, you know? And probably not until we saw him play in college and how dominant he was in college. I was like, wow, this could really turn into something. And even though he escalated his career quickly by the one and done, if you look at him now, he's still getting better and better and better. He's in his 11th year now. Like, he's still getting better. And there's, I really believe in that long-term athletic development. Like, you can still continue to improve. You don't have to be like you're at your peak as a junior in high school. You know what I mean? And some kids unfortunately do, but like Kevin was continuing to grow. So that's why I answer that. And I say, I don't know that he possessed anything so specific that would give him that drive. Now, from a personality perspective, I think I could sense he loved the game. He loved being in the gym. And I think it's really hard to maximize your potential unless you really love the game, because let's be real about it. Anybody that loves anything at some point might dislike it for a little bit. Okay. So for example, in my job, I love training athletes. I love it. I wouldn't trade it for the world, but it doesn't mean it's not hard. It doesn't mean I don't have tough days. Okay. So I say that to say you can love basketball, but there's going to be some tough days. There's going to be some tough times. And if you can't work your way through that, then maybe you got to ask yourself, do you really love basketball? And Kevin really, really loves basketball. And his mom is super supportive. His dad is super supportive. He had some really good folks behind him. He's got a huge community in the Prince George's County, Maryland community that really supports him. In fact, he's very supportive of them as well. He opened like a new community center this past year. So, you know, he had the intangibles probably physically, but I think it was that desire and passion early on where he just loves playing. Like, he'd probably, if he didn't make the NBA, I'm sure he'd just still be playing basketball. Like, just loves basketball.
Yeah. Yeah, all these guys, the other coach I've talked to said these players have something inside, just a sickness almost, where they have to be in the gym because they want to be. They love the game. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Now, you just came over from working the strength and conditioning job for the Washington Wizards. So, you're around pros every day, right? Mm-hmm. Let's get more of a general answer. What did those guys possess that got them to that level? I'm talking from the best player, like your Bradley Beal, all the way down to the guy at the end of the bench. Like, what did they possess?
Well, I think, you know, let's isolate Bradley Beal for a second. Bradley is an extremely hard worker. He's very organized. He's very prepared. He's professional. He's professional to the T. When I say that, like, I'm sorry, my Siri came up for some reason when I said that. He's never late for a workout, never late for a practice, shows up even when he's beat to a pulp, which is many nights of the week because he goes so hard every single game. It's a job for him. He also loves basketball, but it's a job for him. And you can't ever not count on him. Okay, so that's number one. There is a skill in showing up. You know, it's easy to show up when you feel good and easy to do drills when you're feeling great. And when you had a good game the night before, it's difficult to show up when you had a crappy game and you feel like junk and your knee is aching you and your body's hurting. And he also spent the early part of his career injured every single year.
Right.
And I really, looking back on the history as I got there, really credit the group that I had worked with that hired me to helping him, you know, get on the healthy track, you know, by the load management aspects and proper training and all that type of stuff. So Bradley is a very organized and professional athlete, like I said. Now, when you look down the line, you know, you got a guy like, well, he's not with the Wizards anymore, but he's in the league right now. Garrison Matthews. He played pretty well for this team last year. 3-point specialist. You know, hey, there's a lot of people in the league that shoot 3-pointers now. Why would he make it? Well, you know, there's a lot of roles and responsibilities. And I think he was the guy that really understood his role and responsibility. And I think, like anything else in life, in any job, you know, my job is the strength coach, okay, for the Wizards. It was. If I decided my job was all of a sudden one day, hey, I'm going to be the skills coach. And because I know some dribbling drills, or I know some good shooting workouts, or this guy's hurting, I want to play therapist. I'm going outside of my role and responsibility. Now, all of a sudden, I'm not doing my job. And I think the guys that are able to stick into the league are the ones that truly understand that. They understand their role and responsibility. In the case of Garrison, his job was to go out there, whether it was 2 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, go out there and play as hard as you can. And you play defense with as much effort as you possibly can, and you knock down shots. And that's what he did. And that allowed him to get on the radar. I will say, however, because I've always been a big college basketball fan, it really was amazing to me that, like, during free agent workouts and pre-draft workouts we had, you know, you'd have guys coming in to work out and see where they're at and see if they might be a potential draft pick. And, you know, coming off the NCAA tournament, which I love watching like everybody else, you'd see some of these high profile guys like, oh, I remember that guy, you know, this guy, that guy, he played great in the tournament, you know, all over the TV, this and that, blah, blah, blah. And they come work out and they don't even get a sniff in the NBA. I mean, good athletes, good players, killed it in college and don't even get to sniff the NBA. It's just, that just reminded me that the NBA is just such a different level from NCAA Division I men's basketball. It was just such a different level. And, you know, you've got to have a lot of these intangible characteristics. I mean, things that you wouldn't necessarily think about to the average peripheral person looking outside in. Wingspan, okay. You know, like a good friend of mine, coaching friend of mine, who's famous basketball player years ago with the Boston Celtics, D. Brown, okay, had the famous slam dunk, the no-look slam dunk. I worked with him in China several years. And the funniest thing, one time, I remember, he's 6'1", and he went up to the wingspan chart and put his arms out, 6'11", okay? 6'1", and then a 6'11 wingspan. So when you look at the stat sheet, oh, this guy's 6'1", whatever, you know. No, that guy can pick your pocket from across the court, you know. So all these little intangibles of wingspan, of quickness, of explosiveness off the ground, there's a lot that goes into this. The ability to perform under pressure, the conditioning level, your body fat, how well you recover, you know, there's a lot of things that go into allowing these guys to perform day in and day out. But it's a very special person to be able to stay at that level for a long time.
Yeah, working at the highest level, Blair, what were some of the benefits of working with the Wizards and some of the challenges?
Well, the benefit was, number one, I didn't have to move. So I'm a hometown guy. I was born in D.C. I grew up in Maryland, and I've always been a Washington hometown fan. So that was really cool. You know, and I'm a basketball junkie, so really neat. You know, John Wall, Brad Beal, you know, big fan of those guys. And so it was cool to really to see, like, look, I've been training young athletes my whole life. I've been around several professional athletes, but it was great to really get the experience, like, day to day with them 24/7, because you really are with them all the time. And my wife will attest to that as well. I mean, you're on the road, you're traveling. You get to see the highs and lows of the NBA season and see how difficult it is. And that gave me a really important perspective on how these athletes need to be trained and taken care of and to help them perform at their best. So there was a major positive there. And also too, I'm just very intrigued about the inner workings of a basketball business. It's an organization. My company here, Healthy Ballers, an organization, and there's things that make it go well, and you can learn from any organization. So I learned a lot with how, you know, things were run inside the NBA organization, the Wizards, and helped me. Hopefully, you know, I feel like it's made me a better coach, a better businessman, just a better person overall. In terms of the negatives, you know, the negatives are like, it's all relative, you know, like, yeah, you're away from home a lot. So you're away from family. It's a difficult schedule. You come home late on the road and you get up early for practice the next day. And it's a challenging 24/7 schedule. And I would say that's probably the biggest negative, but like, it wasn't a negative for me because I love basketball. Like, I just love basketball. First thing I do, I try to be the first one in the facility every morning, along with our player development guy, Coach David Atkins, that was there. He's now with Clippers, but I'm there in the morning shooting before I want to get my weight workout. You know, the first one in the gym just to shoot, just because I kind of had to with traffic and stuff. I had to drive an hour away, but you know, that would be a con. It's just a schedule, man. It's challenging. It's tough. You know that you're gonna have so many games. You got 82 games at a minimum, hopefully, and you know, a good season. You know, a good season. You're gonna you know, you're going to lose about 35-40% of those. You know what I mean? So there's going to be a lot of losses in that spectrum. You got to learn how to deal with those. You know, that's just part of the process.
Yeah. Good season too. You play an extra 28 games, right?
Exactly. Right. Exactly. Right.
Hey, let's get into an area here where I think a lot of our listeners will benefit from. And that's just some tips you might have on conditioning and nutrition, and everything, and some other things. For an average high school player out there right now, what are the three top exercises or lifts they can do that'll get the most bang for their buck for the game of basketball?
Well, look, man, so everybody's one body. You have one body and it all works together, whether you're playing basketball, football, baseball, whatever. Your body moves as a unit. So collectively, you know, you're going to want to strengthen, you know, the full body. So how do you do that? You're going to want to focus on major movements that address the full body. One of our favorite exercises, because it's safe and easy to teach and very transferable, is a trap bar deadlift. Okay, so it's working just about almost every muscle in the body. That's important for sport, you know. So I don't necessarily want to take one or two exercises and say, hey, this is great for basketball. I would really focus on getting strong in the body for basketball, right? So maybe the better point to start is, like, you know, what gets injured the most? Okay, so ankles, knees, groins, because there's probably going to be a lot of kids out there that are looking for that special exercise that'll help them jump higher. But if you're always twisting your ankle and you're always, you know, you're always coming down funny and you buckle your knee, or your groin feels funny when you're doing defensive slides at the beginning of the year, you're not helping anybody if you're always hurt, you know? So I would put it out there, if you want, Corey, you know, have people email me and I'll be happy to send a video or two of, you know, some specific stuff. That's always welcome. But I would say, you know, hey, look, take care of your ankles. And one of the major ways we do that every single day is work on balance. So balancing on one leg is an easy way to do that. And you can challenge yourself by reaching with your hands, for example, if you can picture that, reaching your hands in different directions. That's one. We call that a hand driver. You can balance on one leg and use your feet to reach, you know, almost like you're pointing out to a clock. Say you're standing on one leg and you're pointing out to 12 o'clock. And then you point out to 3 o'clock and you point out to 6, called foot drivers, moving the feet around in different directions as it creates different demands for the ankle joint to help stabilize and be stronger. Stuff like that is really, really important to do on a regular basis. You know, exercises to help strengthen the knee joint. You're looking above and below. So you're going to want to get the quads and hamstrings strong. So some major movements like single leg exercises, you know, like lunge variations, step up, step downs, you know, single leg is really a great way to start with building some good foundational strength to help basketball athletes and have a good body control.
What are some mistakes you see with kids that go in the weight room, maybe without a trainer like yourself? What are some mistakes teenage athletes are making nowadays? Is it not focusing on the ankle and knees and just going and doing bench and squats, or what are you thinking? What have you seen?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's probably similar to what we would have seen even long ago, like even with the advent of social media. You know, it's very common to know kids are really focused on the show muscles. What are the show muscles? The chest and the biceps. Those are the ones you can see in the mirror, okay, front of your body. But they really have very little impact on performance. Why? Because the back of your body is really those are the go muscles. So that's what we always say, show versus go. So the kids that are typically doing the bench press, the bicep curls, you know, front shoulder type stuff, because again, that's what you are readily available to see. And those are always a prominent part of workouts, it seems to be, for young athletes, or at least they seem to be familiar with early on. You know, what do you bench? What do you bench? Versus working on the posterior chain, your butt, your hamstrings, your low back, your calves. Okay, those are the muscles that make you go, you know, make you explode, help you jump, help you be more powerful. And so probably not having a good grasp, you know, of what's going to help really intentionally change their performance, you know, early on in their training career.
Gotcha. Okay. Do players need a weight room or a trainer or special equipment to get to where they need to be? Or can they do all this on their own in their house? And you mentioned a trap bar. Not everyone's going to have a trap bar.
Yeah, so. You're right. Exactly right. Now, you can do a ton of great bodyweight work. I actually have a PDF, a basketball bodyweight PDF that's really good. It's just for the basketball. You can do a ton of great work. But like anything else, I really do firmly believe in like good quality instruction. You know, sometimes kids will do exercises they may or may not know why they can't move a certain way. Why can't they squat all the way down like their friend? They may not know what the restriction is, if it's ankles, hips, whatever, or tightness somewhere else. I would really encourage, you know, someone to do some research online if you can't afford a trainer, and look at how to do a proper squat, a proper push-up, because some of these exercises get butchered terribly. You know, just regular pull-ups, rows. Learn how to do good foundational exercise work. Hopefully through a good qualified trainer, or just, you know, look somewhere online for, there's a million resources nowadays with the internet. So, a lot of great ways to check in. You know, the work ethic part is easy, right? Like there's a lot of kids that want to do the work and like, you know, don't have a coach and stuff. But it's sort of a bummer. And this was me really in a nutshell, is I would try all these programs. I just didn't have the direction or the knowledge to know like, what's enough? What's too much? I feel good. I want to do more. Okay. You don't know if you should be laying off. I mean, I had early in my life, I had shin splints for like 2 years straight because I just beat myself to a pulp because I just didn't know any better. I mean, my shins were tender literally for 2 years. I just didn't know, because I just kept working because that was what I was supposed to do, what I thought I was supposed to do, you know? So, you know, I know it's not an ideal answer, because you would hope that, hey, yeah, of course, you can certainly go out and do it on your own. I mean, and there are kids that do it, and there are kids that probably have success, but I think you'd probably find yourself having a faster rate of success if you get someone knowledgeable to help kind of guide you. You know, they don't have to be a crazy experienced or expensive personal trainer on your shoulder. Like, it might be worth having a conversation with somebody, just getting feedback. That might be the game changer a kid needs, you know, like there's ways to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. And you and I spent hours talking on road trips about nutrition. And this was 10 years ago, and even a lot's changed since then. Give me the basics for a kid on nutrition and sleep, what they should be aiming for.
Absolutely. Yeah, I just posted this to my Instagram not too long ago. Dr. Sherry Ma, she's a sleep science researcher, and she did what was called the Stanford Basketball Study. And basically, in a nutshell, they encouraged the athletes to try to get like an additional hour of sleep as best they could. And then they took, you know, statistics on their free throws and 3-point shooting percentage, that sort of thing. And so that additional 30, 45, 60 minutes made a tremendous impact on their ability to score and shoot. And so as a young athlete, and then I'll put on top of this too, there is a research study by the American Academy of Pediatrics. I could send it over to if you want, that shows that athletes that get regularly less than 7 hours of sleep are significantly higher risk of injury than those that are not. And they were measuring that against several other variables of like, well, maybe the kids are playing too much. There's too many games. There's too many workouts and practices. But they found within that study that 7 hours or less on a regular basis, that was the major factor of increasing injury risk. And so I was like, man, that's a big one. That's a big one. And that's got to be a conversation, because living in the DC metro area and knowing how competitive athletics are here, not only athletics, but academics, super competitive. Man, a lot of these kids are not sleeping 7 hours. They might be lucky to get six, because some of these schools require 3 hours of homework a night. And then you got to perform on the court or field. And then, you know, it's not always easy to get your homework done right after school. You might up till 12 or 1 o'clock, got to get back up at 6:37. A lot of these kids are not getting enough sleep. You know, they're just not. So I would say, hey, look, kids, if you can shoot for a minimum of 8, that's ideal. And I've always been a fan of sleeping versus being the kid who's got to get up at 5 a.m. to do the grinding workouts, right? You know, hey, check me out. I'm up here at 5 a.m. I'm working while you're sleeping. It sounds good in the short term. Mm-hmm. It's not a long-term play. It's just not a long-term play. I can appreciate the motivation and the intention, but if you're so busy that you can't do what you need to do later in the day, then maybe you're just too busy for basketball, you know? So sleep's number one. From a nutrition perspective, I'm really into the nutrition science. And, but you know, working with athletes of all levels, I've realized like really got to maintain the basics. That's difficult enough for people. How much water do you get? Do athletes know how much water to get? Many of them don't. Okay. The quick equation on a general spectrum is you take your body weight divided by 2. And that would give you the minimum amount of ounces per day. So for example, if an athlete weighed 200 pounds, subtract that by 2 or divided by 2, I'm sorry. Then you got 100 ounces at the minimum. That's if you're not working out. If you're working out, you're going to want to add 15 to 20% because all that sweat you're giving up. Okay. Mm-hmm. So if we do that, now you're looking at about 115, 120 ounces a day of water. That's the minimum. And many kids can't even do that. Why? Because they're drinking all kinds of junk. They're drinking sodas and iced teas and lemonades and stuff like that. Okay. So foundationally, water, if you don't get that, that's a stopping point. So at least you got to be educated to know that. And then nutritionally, I found over time, I haven't really had to ask many questions because most kids don't get enough protein in their diet. Okay. The meat, beef, fish, chicken, eggs, whatever. They don't eat enough of it. Okay. And what people find is if you eat enough protein, you get full faster. It's very satiating. Okay. It's not about a high carb, low carb situation. As a basketball player, you got to eat carbs. You got to eat a bunch of carbs. It's hard to survive and get enough calories. Okay. And so protein is a discussion where I learned this from a group called Precision Nutrition, which I'm certified by. They're in my mind, the top leading nutritional, especially from a behavior standpoint, nutritional group in the world. And they do a good job of like helping athletes really measure out like what a plate should look like. So for example, like the size of your palm could be like one good serving of protein. Everybody's a little bit different, of course, size-wise, your hand's bigger than mine, whatever, but that's a good measuring point, starting point. And kids could look at that and see, am I getting one or two palms every meal? No way, I'm not even close. Okay, well, maybe I'm not in the range I'm supposed to be. And so that's where I start to get in and have a conversation with them. And outside of that, it's like, hey man, do you ever eat fruits and vegetables? And it's usually pretty minimal. So it's, you don't have to go too far. And I'm telling you, Corey, 20 plus years in this business, nothing's ever going to beat the foundations of getting good quality sleep, drinking enough quality water, okay, and eating good whole unprocessed foods, okay? Now, when I say whole unprocessed foods, it doesn't mean that that we're not going to have Doritos once in a while. We might not have Ben and Jerry's ice cream once in a while. It just means like try to get the majority of your food where it's real food, right? You got chicken, it's just chicken. It's not chicken in 40 ingredients. Or you got a potato or you got a piece of fruit, strawberry. Strawberry is a strawberry. It's not strawberry in like ingredients you can't pronounce, okay? And I think if kids start thinking in that concept, they're just going to be better off. Again, like I said, it doesn't mean that they shouldn't go have that slice of pizza or two every so often. You know, it just shouldn't dominate their diet, you know? And even at the upper levels of the NBA, you know, not everybody eats pristine and perfect, but the guys that recover really well, the guys that perform really well, they tend to do a little better on the diet side, you know, most of the time.
All right, diet side. Say I'm a kid at an AU tournament and we pulled over to a convenience store, right? Yeah. What items would you suggest in there that are safe for, like, not safe, but what are the whole foods or the best options both to drink that aren't water and to snack on?
Yeah, great question. I'm actually going to be doing some posting this in the next several months because I used to do them like I did it with Wendy's and I did it with Chipotle.
That's right.
They got some pretty good feedback. And so I do want to do like the gas station because you're going to stop there. But here, man, like great example is like, let's say you came off a game, okay, mm-hmm. and you want something really quick. I mean, there's tons of research on low fat chocolate milk being a great protein to carbohydrate ratio. I mean, I don't know any kid that doesn't love chocolate milk, okay? So that's one easy one right there. Okay. It's got a great ratio of protein to carbohydrates for a post-workout or post-game. So that's an easy one there. Can't go wrong with a piece of fruit because it's just a piece of fruit. You know, bananas are easy ones to get there. Okay.
They are. I'm just going to cut in that convenience store fruits usually the bottom of the of the list of good looking options as far as fruit goes, right?
No doubt. But we are at a convenience store. True. I can't say Skittles, you know, even though I'm sure we'll end up getting banana, chocolate milk and Skittles for dessert or whatever like that. Other easy options you can look for, whether they have it or not, you know, is a yogurt. You know, Greek yogurt is a phenomenal resource, you know, high in protein, got some good carbs in it. And yogurts are going to be really good. Beef jerky, you're going to want to take a look at the beef jerky that's like, has minimal ingredients. You know, some of them have a ton, some of them have minimal. Try to stick to one with less ingredients is ideal. But yeah, keeping things really basic, you're going to get pretty minimal options at the convenience store. You know, but between chocolate milk, a nice healthy piece of fruit if you can find one, and banana is usually a pretty easy one because it's protected in such a shell, and it's a good quick healthy carb with a little bit of fiber. Good nutrients in that. That's an easy way to go. Yogurt, most places have that. And certainly a convenience store is always going to have some beef jerky for a little bit of protein. So you can mix and match there. But I've always been really a peanut butter. I don't like jelly, but I have to say peanut butter jelly because that's so just normal. But peanut butter and jelly are easy ones to knock up as well. You know, like, you know, get a loaf of bread and get some peanut butter and jelly. And in between, that's a really quick, easy pick me up, you know, in between a game, quick energy there that can last a little bit. So, you know, keep things simple because you got to understand where you are. You're not at a Ruth Chris trying to order, you know, grass fed filet mignon. You know what I mean? You're going for quick and simple. What we want to do at these places is avoid eating like three packs of Skittles or Sour Patch Kids, even though they're incredible. Right. You want to avoid that. You want to avoid getting the soda and get a large water. Okay. Like I think you can make good and bad decisions anywhere, You know, whether people want to like demonize McDonald's or whatever, there's good and bad decisions at McDonald's too. Like, you know, are any of them the best? No. I mean, but if you're stuck, and sometimes these kids are at the mercy of the AAU tournament budget, you know, you might have $20 a kid or whatever, or $15 a kid, and you got to get food on the go. Everybody's going to McDonald's. What are you going to do? You know, they should understand and learn those best options at each of those places. And they can check out my Wendy's video to sort of get a reference on that. And I'm going to be doing one like on Chick-fil-A, because Chick-fil-A is a really popular one too. That's an easy one, because so many kids go there, especially in our area here in the DMV. So, but yeah, that's a great question. Yeah.
You know, a question I asked you 10 years ago that you paused on, I said, what's better for you, a beer, a 12-ounce beer, or a 12-ounce Mountain Dew? And obviously this is for those of you above 21, but you paused. And I don't even know if you gave me an answer. So 10 years later, what's better for you, a beer? Not better, but what's least harmful, a beer or a Mountain Dew?
Yeah, I'm gonna have to go with Mountain Dew, because the alcohol is certainly, it's toxic.
Yeah.
You know, okay, in some capacity, right? So, but yeah, for the 21 and over crowd, I mean, yeah, I love a glass of beer for sure every so often. But there's a reason why it beats you up after you have a handful of them too.
Yeah.
So I don't know that I've had a Mountain Dew hangover, you know, but I've certainly had a hangover from some beers. So.
All right. You answered that much quicker now, 10 years later. So
yeah,
that's good.
Yeah.
what have you, and speaking of 10 years, what did you used to do 10 years ago that with newer research, you don't do anymore, or you've kind of pivoted on?
Oh, that's a good question. Yeah. So, years ago, just for experience and knowledge wise, I hired a coach to learn more about like just getting lean, basically.
Yep.
And we utilized a style called intermittent fasting, which is, you know, ever popular now. And I did that for a long time. And basically, for the crowd listening that may or may not be familiar, intermittent fasting is basically you take a window of the day where you eat inside the window, and then you don't eat anything else. So for example, the easy way to think about it is like, let's say I don't eat breakfast and I start by eating lunch at 12 o'clock, and then I'm not going to have anything past 8. So 12 to 8 is an 8-hour window where I eat, and then 16 hours of the day, I don't eat. And there's a lot of positive research on the health aspects of that. Although, you know, people can take it out of context really quickly. You know, it's not necessarily for everybody. And that's something I was doing a lot because it was just convenient. I'm working a lot of hours. I felt very clear in the head when I wasn't, you know, just eating first thing in the morning. It's just how I felt. It was super easy for me to stay lean, as I'm a lean guy anyways. It's really easy. And it's something I don't do anymore just because, I use it as a tool occasionally when I need to, meaning like if I'm on the go, I can survive until 1, 2, 3 o'clock without eating. My preference is not to, is because I'm trying to, you know, make sure I don't get so run down at the end of the day. Like, even though I'm not working at the clip that I did probably 10 years ago, I'm working at a smarter, more efficient clip, but like, I still need energy, you know, and for me personally, I want to have my protein levels at a certain point every day. It makes it tough for me to get that in that window of 8 hours. So I really want to get a breakfast, lunch, dinner, and hit heavy protein to fit my needs. So, and also too, I'm not a fan of it for athletes. Why? Because mathematically, if you don't eat breakfast or eat early on in the day, you're going to be at such a deficit of where you need to be. And let's know who we're talking to. We're talking to these young, skinny basketball players that want to gain weight and get stronger, right? And these tend to be the kids that are like, yeah, I'm not hungry in the morning, I don't eat anything, whatever. And they're skinny as a rail. But you can teach yourself to eat in the morning. It doesn't mean you need to sit down, put in your napkin and your shirt and sit down for 45 minutes. It just means you need to start small, get something in your system. And over time, you're going to start waking up a little more hungry and you're going to get in a routine. And so I find it's virtually impossible to meet all your calorie needs as a growing, developing athlete. And from a young age, if you're missing breakfast.
Yeah, great point. So, okay. Good to know on the intermittent fasting. I do that. I've been doing that probably since you introduced me to it. and just love the only two meals a day. And I love the clarity in the morning, and it keeps me lean now that I want to be lean and I don't want to put on muscle anymore. It works. Last question here before the lightning round. You worked with pro organizations in Asia and Australia. What do they do better in terms of strength and conditioning, and what do they not do as well as Americans do? Or is there even a difference?
It's a good question. I would say, like, in the Asia, in my experiences around Asia, it was just more of a lack of knowledge, lack of experience. And it wasn't a lack of desire to learn. It was just lack of true, like, experience and just education over there. And that was part of my job, was to, when I was working with a team, helping players, helping coaches, was to educate some of the staff on, you know, why I would be doing some of the things that I'm doing, and help them sort of parlay that into their philosophy or whatever they wanted to do training wise. Australia was a different animal, because Australians tend to be at the top of their game with sports science and education, and just really, really sharp community of people in general. In fact, one of my early visits to Sydney, it would have been 2006. It's the first time I saw a force plate, which, for those that don't know what a force plate is you're standing on two big metal plates or a big metal plate, and you jump on it, and it gives you really in-depth information about your athletic profile from a jumping perspective. Like where in the jump you're producing force. Are you producing it more on the left side, right side? Really intricate information. So 2006, like, this is like, whoa, like, what is this thing? Because it wasn't something I was familiar with, even though I had worked in the NFL and the NHL even before that. And so I got to see that the Canberra, it was the Institute of Australian Institute of Performance. I can't remember the, I'm embarrassed that I'm messing it up. It was in Canberra. It was their main training center, their popular training center for all their athletes. Aussies are going to hate me for that, because it's been so long, but anyways, that was a full on teched out place. So they were really sharp, and the strength coaches that I had met, there were definitely probably more ahead of the curve than a lot of our American counterparts, you know, from what I can say. And I say that more from, like, the stuff that I saw, the technology and the recovery aspects, especially. I learned so much on recovery when I got there. My first trip, it was just stuff that we, you know, maybe had been going on in the US for many years, but this wasn't, like, discussed like now. Like now, recovery is such a specific topic. It's like a very specific, and it's a marketable, you know, business driven topic, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, that's cool. And you working in all these different countries and different leagues, I mean, you're going to take a lot from each, and then that's what makes healthy baller such a unique animal. So
yeah, exactly.
All right, here's a quick lightning round here at the end. When you work out, what's your favorite and least favorite lift or exercise to do?
Oh, good question. Well, it used to be the rear foot elevated split squat was my least favorite. I just hate it. I'm starting to enjoy it a little bit more now. I don't know why. I think sometimes these things happen where you just have a love-hate relationship of certain exercises. It's a great exercise. One that I'll throw in that mix that I want to challenge myself to get better with is a one-legged unsupported squat. So just picture standing on like an 18-20-inch box, and you do sort of like a pistol type squat, all on one leg with not balancing on anything. So I really hate that exercise, but it's so valuable and one that I'm not as strong at that I want to want as I want to be. So I'm continuing to work on that. Favorite exercise probably has to be, the trap bar deadlift. You know, just so much bang for your buck there. You know, that's always a staple in the routine in some way, shape, or form. You know, but with all this stuff, I mean, it's cycles, you know, because, you know, there's so much more than just the sets and reps that go into all this stuff. It's more about applying it to, like, you know, balancing it within the life of, like, of work and other stressors, right? So it's not always like grindy. It's just, to me now, it's more about consistent effort, just showing up. Like I said, showing up is a skill. and being consistent. And that's something that I can admit I struggled with over this past year of like just getting back into normal private business, like transitioning, finding my feet again. You know, even though I own a business and it's all functional and doing well, it's just like trying to find my feet again was challenging. So the workout routines that sometimes took to the wayside, you know. There's so many other factors that go into making that determine whether or not workouts work. Okay. Like, you know, like I said, if you're not drinking enough water, good luck. If you're not sleeping enough, definitely have no shot. Okay. You want to gain muscle or lose body fat. If you're not sleeping enough, you have no shot. Like it's going to be really, really difficult. Just more challenging. Maybe the unicorns will get away with it, but most of us know.
Yeah, and cortisol, I know you mentioned that to me too. And what was it you mentioned once about like your electricity, not your electricity in your body, but your neural system, how it's firing. If it's fried, it won't do as well.
Yeah, your central nervous system. Yes. Yeah. So yes. if you're just absolutely toasty, you know, meaning like say you had a, you know, you played a hard basketball game the day before, or you had a really tough lift. And maybe your muscles feel good. It's just, you're not like, you don't feel like you're firing off really powerful. Like most people would think like, okay, I'm just not jumping as high today for some reason. Can't tell why. And most kids might think, well, I'm getting worse. You know, well, a lot of times it's just your central nervous system, mm-hmm. your neurological system's just a little toasty and is in the recovery process. You're just not able to produce the same output. And stuff like that, you know, it's a great topic because now, like I said, with the force plates, I'm using them in my gym on a regular basis. And so I get that immediate feedback from my athletes to know, you know, they might tell me, hey, I feel good, or I feel a little off today. I'll know for sure. Like I get it. I really get a good glimpse to know, like objectively, you know, where they were before, where they are now and where we're going. It helps me make better decisions on the training plan and process.
Yeah. That's good to have that technology for sure. In your days of playing, even as post high school, who's the best player you ever played against?
Well, that's a good question. I've played against D Brown. Well, not against D Brown, like played with him. That's like goofing off. Miles Simon, played one-on-one with him a lot. He would always beat me down. Miles was a NCAA collegiate champion at Arizona. Mid-90s, awesome player. He's an assistant coach with the LA Lakers. He was always at those China camps, so we'd always goof off and do shooting contests and one-on-one stuff. He'd always kick my butt. A funny story, especially since Ben Simmons is a hot topic today. I had played against Ben Simmons when he was a sophomore in high school, and he was at, it was like a Jordan All-American Classic game, and they had like the international youth side, they always bring in like the 16 and under guys. And he was part of that group and they didn't have all their players there. And I was there because I used to work that event and they were short on some guys. So I had to jump in a couple of drills and I was guarding Ben Simmons for a little bit. And that was absolutely terrible. He was humongous even as a 16-year-old. You know, but I've messed around with a lot of these guys before, you know what I mean? Just like on the court, just goofing off. I've been in a handful of the drills, you know, during Wizards practice sometimes, you know, nothing crazy. I'm not like, mm-hmm. not like getting up and down, you know, but just being the screen guy, cause they love punching me around and stuff. So
what are your hobbies? In that manner. Oh, there you go. Yeah. Well, they're probably getting back you for all the lifts you put them through.
Yeah.
What are your hobbies when you're not coaching?
Yeah. Right now, so when we were in the bubble, we got a chance to play a lot of golf, and that was a pretty cool experience, you know, just being in the bubble, just to have some downtime and be outside. And I had played a little bit of golf when I was younger, but nothing serious. And so I promised myself when I had gotten out that I would really make an effort to learn it, and I want to be pretty good at it. So that's number one right now, what I'm doing. I love being outside. It gets me a chance to be off the electronics, and I can focus on one task at a time. And sort of lets my brain kind of free flow. So I like to get out and play a little golf when I can. It's not as often as I like, but if I'm doing too much, I'm probably not working enough. So that's one hobby. My other hobby, which is probably not the best hobby in the world, is poker. I love playing poker. I love the competitiveness the competitiveness of it. I love the mathematical side of it. I really enjoy that process, even though it's such an emotional roller coaster. Working out now more than ever this year has been my medicine. So I'll consider that my hobby. It's like, I look at it more as medicine than I do as like, hey, I want to get stronger or something. I just, that's the only thing in my life that I can attest to saying, like, when I don't feel great, if I do that, I always feel better. You know, I might not feel my best, but like, if I'm not feeling very good, like my energy's low or I'm just like in a bad mood, working out always fixes that. And so I would call that like my ultimate hobby. And I'm not crazy. I don't go crazy. I'm not working out 7 days a week, but I am trying to do something almost every day, something small, right? And it might be a little jog. It might be go outside and shoot a little hoop. It might be lifting weights. It could be anything. It's just something to like get moving. And I found that to be really important for me. And outside of that, I'm still looking for other hobbies. I really want to snowboard. I know that you guys are out in Colorado, so I would dream to get out there and snowboard a little bit. But so many of these things are so time consuming, you know?
Yeah, right. Yeah, you're always welcome. Come on out. I got a board and skis. We'll do whatever you want. And I know the spots now after being out here a couple of years. Last question, Blair, what is your favorite movie of all time?
Oh, man.
Or top couple.
Is it? Well, I guess I might lose some respect here by my answer, but I'd rather be transparent than not. I love Dumb and Dumber. That's one of the funniest things I've ever seen in my entire life. That's one of the funniest ones ever. I've always been a big comedy guy, and I guess if I'm going to go down that road, I'd have to say the Naked Gun series is probably for me like the ultimate. When I was young, a little funny story about this, Leslie Nielsen was the famous actor for the Naked Gun, and I just thought he was the funniest human being known to man. And those movies came out for me when I was like 12 years old, basically, or earlier. And so Leslie Nielsen, I saw the ad in the paper that he was coming to a nearby mall to sign like a book or whatever. And I was like, oh man, it'd be so cool to meet Leslie Nielsen. But just because I was young and I wasn't driving and I wasn't in control of my life, I didn't think twice to be like, hey, ask anybody if I could go see this person. And then, a handful of years later, he passed away, and I was like, so like frustrated that I didn't get a chance to meet him. But I'm a big comedy guy. I feel like laughter for me is like my savior. I've been around some people that I've worked with in the past, a couple people that I work with now are just really, really funny people. And I'm always driven to comedy type of film, just because it's nothing makes me feel better,
Perfect. Where can people find you online?
Online, you can find me at healthyballer_OG. That's my Instagram. We are not as active on Twitter, although I do retweet a bunch of stuff that I like, but trying to get better on Twitter. We are healthyballer, just at healthyballer. And then Facebook, we're there as well, at healthyballer. But Instagram at healthyballer is probably the prime spot to really see what we have going on as a business. My account for Healthy Baller OG is just a year old, and I'm doing my best at like trying to get some stuff going on that and just trying to provide some content, while doing all this work and stuff. But, I've realized over these past few weeks, like my goal moving forward is sort of what it was before, but it's a little more clear for me now. I want to help athletes make better decisions. And as long as I can educate them on their options, if they make a bad decision, relative to what they think bad decision is, it's their call. And when I say bad decision, I mean like, okay, you're at a buffet. You went to the buffet with your team and stuff, and what Coach Blair probably wants you to focus on for your main meal, but instead you go to the ice cream sundae line and just focus on that as your main meal. Like, that's probably not a great decision. You know what I mean? So helping kids make better decisions on the nutrition aspect, training and recovery aspect, performance, performance side, just being a better teammate as well, making good decisions that will help them be better people in their life. I'm excited about that.
Yeah. Well, thanks for sharing that. And Blair, it's a pleasure having you on today. We go way back. You're one of my first friends in DC when I moved there, and we had some good times and road trips. And like I said, without you inadvertently connecting me to Jerry Ho, there's no prep athletics where it is today. So I want to thank you for that. And thank you for being a friend. And I look forward to seeing where Healthy Baller goes. Folks, if you enjoyed this today, be sure to follow on all major podcasting platforms. You can subscribe to those. You can subscribe to YouTube and make sure you don't miss anything else. And Blair, thanks again for coming on. And
appreciate having me.
Yeah, we'll see you guys next week. Thanks so much.